everybody. My name is Anna Bryce, and I am the VP of Programming at the AMA Phoenix. And welcome. We are thrilled to have you here. And we are just going to jump straight into the presentation. I am pleased to introduce Ben Holland, who is a great friend of the AMA Phoenix. He is also a past president of the AMA Phoenix. He has been a speaker for us before, and we are asking him back again because he is an expert on everything Google Analytics. So we are thrilled to have him here. He has been working in marketing and entrepreneurship for the past 15 plus years, and he's kind of done every angle of business. He's owned his own business, he's worked at marketing agencies, and he's worked on the corporate side of business as well as the consulting side of business. So he's really done every angle of business that you can think of. We are thrilled to have him because he no longer lives here in Phoenix anymore. So he's coming to us all the way from Connecticut, way back on the East Coast, my old stomping ground. So Ben, welcome and thank you. We are thrilled to have you here today.
Awesome. Thank you so much for having me. And thanks to everybody at the AMA, especially, you know, Anna and Taylor, who helped facilitate this. And if any of you are on the fence about joining the AMA, I would highly recommend it. I can't say many more great things about it than how much it's helped my career, gotten me to where I am. So if you're on the fence, if you're not a member, if you're coming to this presentation, highly consider getting that membership. It's a lot cheaper now than it's ever been. And it's well worth it. The networking, the meeting, you're going to get your money's worth very quickly. But thank you for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today, we're going to be talking about Google Analytics. And you'll notice some things during my presentation is one, I talk really, really fast. Two, I go through a lot of slides. And three, I have a lot of URLs on my slides that lead you to more resources. So you will get a copy of the slides at the end of this presentation. You don't need to worry about writing everything down. We'll send it out. The AMA already has it. I sent it over to Anna a couple minutes ago. So they'll disperse that, you know, afterwards. Feel free to answer any questions you have. I'll be able to answer a couple at the end of the presentation. I do have to leave a little bit early, but I'll get through everything. So I'm only taking a couple questions here at the end. But shoot them in the chat and we'll get to them. And if not, you can always message me on my LinkedIn here. And then you can also email me at ben@sigbrand.com with any questions. A little bit about me. I just moved to Connecticut a while ago. And I'm the vice president of partnership for Signature Brand Factory, and also do some marketing directing for a conference company called Influence Group. If you guys need any help with your marketing, please reach out to me. It's a great organization. We'd be happy to find a marketing solution for you. Signature Brand Factory does it all. Some of these slides are going to have the social icons in the top right corner. That means, hey, you might want to share this. So I'm going to pause, let you take a screenshot or a photo with your camera and let you put it up on social media. If you choose to do that, please use the hashtag Sig Brand. All right, so let's get into the agenda. First, we're going to talk about Google Analytics, kind of what it is, get you up to speed, talk about the front end. Then we're going to talk about the account optimization. That's everything you need to do on the back end to get it humming, get clean data. We're going to solve a spike, which is a pretty common problem you run into in analytics. I'm going to talk briefly about reporting with Data Studio, which is my preferred platform of reporting with Google Analytics. And then at the end, I'm going to go through a quick lightning round where I talk about a lot of useful tools that you might not know about that I think you should. So anytime, just throw some questions in here. We are saving them for the end, but they'll categorize them. They'll pick the best couple for the very end. So what is Google Analytics? It can be a little confusing. So the first place you want to look to learn more about Google Analytics is like a talk or something like this. So thank you for joining me and showing an interest. After this talk, if I've sparked anything in your mind and you want to learn more, check out Google Analytics Academy. This is a great resource. It starts from beginner, so it gives you the basics. It goes in depth, so a lot more than I'm going to cover here. You'll learn everything you need to go. And then it'll train you all the way up to the enterprise version if you guys need that. So it's great. It gives you a certificate. You can put it on your LinkedIn, on your resume. It's a really great product. You should check it out, and it's free. I'm also going to be referencing a blog post I did about 6 years ago now, and it gives you all the how-tos do everything. So I'll have screenshots, step-by-step how-tos. It'll explain a lot of stuff and links to useful things. So this is kind of where you go. If you want to implement what I'm talking about today, especially in the back end, you know, where we're optimizing your account in the admin settings, this is going to be the how-to, the walkthrough. You're going to use this as your Bible when you're setting everything up. So if you want to take a screenshot of that, feel free. All right. So the first thing I want to talk about is, what is Google Analytics? So you might not know at all what Google Analytics is, but it's software that is on the internet. It's a web-based software that Google provides, and it allows you to see how users interact with your website. You can see where they come from, what they do on your website, how they're converting, and not who they are, but some information about them, like what devices they're on, what their age is, what their gender is, you know, where they're from. I'm going to be talking about something called Universal Analytics. And now there's a new analytics out there called Google Analytics 4. It's a rebrand of something called Web and App Analytics that's been around forever, but they're kind of rebranding it. It's going to be the future for this cookie-less world that we may or may not be living in, you know, in 2023. They keep pushing that date back. So this is about Universal Analytics. They're very different products. So if you're wondering, which one do I have? You have Universal Analytics. Pretty much everybody uses Universal Analytics, and you would know if you had the other one. For differences between the two, you can go to this link. And also, if you're thinking, well, do I want this new one? It's extremely different. There's a big learning curve for it. So I would recommend, if you want to check it out, run them at the same time. It won't hurt your website or anything. So you have the reliance of what you're learning about today in Universal Analytics, which is really what I prefer. I think it's a better product at its current time. All right, so the first thing you're going to see is this interface. And wow, there's a lot of buttons, there's a chart, there's all these things going on. It can be a little confusing and overwhelming. You might just want to close your screen and move on. Well, don't do that. That's what you're here for. First thing we're going to talk about is this left-hand navigation. This is where you get to everywhere in Google Analytics. So the first two parts, reporting and customization, I mean home and customization, are really for reporting. I don't really ever use these at all. I use Google Data Studio for reporting, which I'll talk about a little bit later for a very brief amount of time. But that's what I like to do. I like to just throw in my analytics data into Data Studio, make a custom report that's automated, and then it emails me once a month with all of the data. It's really easy and seamless, and I prefer it. It gives me more freedom than Google Analytics does when I'm trying to make my reports. The next section here on the left-hand navigation is real time. So this is what's happening on your website right now. Now, this is a really cool feature, and it's nice to have it up in your marketing department, and you can see how many people are on the website or where they're coming from, but I don't really see a lot of use cases for this. You know, I really care about aggregated data over 30 days a year, you know, whatever, over happening this instance. But the one thing I really like this real-time section for is testing, right? What I like to do is set up a view, an analytics view that has one filter, and it only allows my IP address. So the only data I'm seeing is me for my IP address. And then I go into the real time. If I'm checking an event I just put in or to see if my analytics tag is implemented properly, I can go to the real time section. I know it's just tracking me because I've used that filter, and I can see what I'm doing on there and double check everything. That's what I really use the real time for, is testing. The next section is the audience. I'm in there all the time. It's who the people are that are coming to your website. Acquisition is, where are they coming from? Behavior is, what did they do on your website? Conversion is sales and goals. And that's stuff you usually have to set up for it to work properly. And we'll talk about setting that all up in the admin section, where all the settings are. All right. So the first section is audience. There's location, age, gender, language, affinity categories, which is from the DoubleClick network. It's like their interests. Like, are they a foodie? Are they a tourist? Do they like sneakers? It just gives you these little categories people fall within. It has a visitor frequency, has the device they're on. So is it an iPhone 10? Is it an iPhone 12? Is it an Android? You can see the specific type. It shows the browser, so you can see how many people are still using IE8 on your website. And also it cross-device tracks from a phone to a tablet to your desktop. So you can see a user across multiple devices, which was a big problem a long time ago, but they really figured it out. So the first thing you're going to see when you get into this audience overview is, again, lots of buttons, lots of data, and you might not know what to do with it. So these first three data points, users, new users, and sessions, are all about how good you are at getting people to your website, right? You want those numbers to be big, you want them to look really good, and you want them to be increasing. You always want more people coming to your website. These next five metrics, the number of sessions per user, page views, sessions per pages per session, duration, and bounce rate, are all how engaged users are when they're on your website. So you want these to be good as well, but they're a sign of how good your website's doing. And the first three are how good your website is at attracting people. I get a lot of questions about bounce rate, and I'm going to talk about a statistic I like a little bit better called exit rate later, but I'll define bounce rate for you now because it comes up quite a bit. So a bounce is when somebody comes to your website and they visit one page and they leave. They could be on the page for 1 second, they could be on the page for 30 minutes, but they visit one page and leave, and that's a bounce. All right, that's different than something else, but that's the definition, and I'll talk about it a little bit later. So I love this part of this section of analytics. It's the demographics overview, because it gives you the age and gender of the users on your website. And I love this for personas. I don't know how many of you are doing persona-based marketing or making content for specific personas, but this is where I start with my personas. I know the gender and the age of my audience immediately and who is interacting with my website. The next one I love is this geo map. I put this in every report I have because it's just so visually easy to understand. It's visually digestible, right? This is the instance from AMA Phoenix from, I think, 2017. And you can see a majority of the users are from Phoenix, right? That makes a lot of sense. But you see a big pocket over here in like West Virginia, Pennsylvania, Maryland area. So maybe we were a business. Let's say we were selling shoes or something and we were only focused on the Phoenix market, but we see we're getting a lot of business from the East Coast. I might want to hire a customer service person, you know, to be there a little bit earlier in the day to handle all those calls or those needs of the customers in the East Coast. And you can quickly figure something like that out with this graph. I would recommend putting this in all of your reports. It's easy for the CEO, the senior leadership team. People who don't know anything about analytics or marketing can get this graph. It makes perfect sense and it conveys it quickly. You don't get a lot of questions from this graph. This other section here I like a lot is the mobile overview. It tells you if your most of your users are on desktop, mobile, or tablet. So I really just care about desktop and mobile because Google has two different indexes for their ranking algorithm. They have a mobile index and a desktop index. And mobile is what's by default. So if you have a lot of mobile traffic on your website, you really need to have a mobile-friendly design. But if you have a lot of desktop traffic, you might want to go that extra mile to go from a mobile site for mobile users and then have it break and be responsive for a desktop user because you have a very high percentage. So what I mean in this instance here is, this is AMA Phoenix, 75% of the users were desktop. So I'm probably going to take the time when building the website to make it three columns. I'm going to add a lot of video and stuff to it. I'm going to make it a little bit fancier, nicer, because I know desktop users usually have faster bandwidth, they have wider screens. No, this is reversed. And only 22% of my traffic was desktop. I might not take the time to invest in a responsive site. I would always use a responsive site, but maybe not a fancy responsive site that has three columns. I might just stick to a single column because it's not worth the time because not a lot of people are going to see it. So you can make these kinds of business decisions here. And another note, if your mobile traffic is pretty low comparatively to desktop and you're just wondering why, it might be because your site's not mobile friendly. Because of that different ranking algorithm for mobile searches. If your site's not mobile friendly, you're not going to rank as well as you do for desktop. And that might be a reason why you have a discrepancy in your traffic between the two technologies. All right, so the next section I have, we'll see if we can get to that at the end, Nathan. That's a very good question. So acquisition, this is where people are coming from. So you can get your organic traffic, which is from a search engine like Google, Bing, DuckDuckGo, AltaVista. You have your advertising traffic. Referral traffic is a link from another website to your site. Social traffic, you know, it's on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Search terms. So I love this search term section. I'm going to dive into it a little bit, but this is what people have searched on Google to get to your website. And then campaign results I'll talk about for a little bit too, because this is how you really digest and track your data within Google Analytics. And it's really something that I love. I'm going to take a quick sip here. Well, right before we talk about this channels report. So here you'll see the all channels report, the all traffic, and it breaks it down into different segments. So I love this sort of thing because I want to know where my traffic's coming from and which channel I really need to focus on to get more traffic. So something I really look for is high search and high direct traffic, because that's in my mind free traffic. I wrote an article or something and it's getting organic search. I don't have to touch it again. Direct traffic, people are typing in my URL. I don't have to do anything for that. Social traffic, I have to post emails. I have to send out emails. Referral traffic, you got to get that link on that website, do a press release or something. And then paid, if paid was in here, you'd have to put money into it. So I like to see a lot of organic and direct at the top. Now, if you have a new website, your website doesn't follow this model, investing in something like paid or the time in social media and email is a great way to bridge that gap. And looking at this chart here, you can see where I need to spend my time, what I need to focus on. All right, the next section. Here, this is the search section, the query section here. So a long time ago in Google Analytics, you used to be able to see what keywords people were typing, what page they landed on, and then you could follow them through the conversion path. It was amazing. It made SEO's jobs really easy. And then they got rid of it. It was all this not provided and not set. So now this, in my opinion, is the next best thing you can possibly get to that. It's better than if you're paying for Ahrefs or SEMrush or any ranking tracking tool. This is straight from the horse's mouth. You can link Google Search Console to Google Analytics And you can see the searches people have done in Google. So this is actual data from Google for how many people have clicked on your keyword, how many impressions your keyword has had, the click-through rate, and then your average position. And it's free. It's free. It's right here. All you have to do is click a couple things in the setting, which I will show you in a couple of minutes to make this happen. But this is great. If you need any really fancy keyword tracking tool, let me know, message me on LinkedIn or email me at bennettsigbrand.com. I can make you a data studio report that gives you really great tracking, you know, and then you don't have to pay Ahrefs or SEMrush a monthly fee or something like that. All right, so the next section I want to talk about is this campaign section. So I want you to bear with me here. Imagine you're doing a big new campaign, you're launching a new product, and you really want to get at it. You want to promote it everywhere. You did a blog post, you're doing press releases, social media posts, you're doing paid advertising, you might have even had a billboard. You're doing everything you possibly can. You sent out an email too. And you want to know which did better. Like, did my social post do better than my email, or is my paid advertising actually making the money? Because a lot of times you'll just do a big campaign, you'll just see traffic all land on a single page. And it's kind of difficult to slice and dice that data up to see which worked best. Like, imagine if you had 8 social posts about it and it all just falls in the social bucket. So what you do is you use something called UTM parameters, and you put a different UTM parameter on the links for each of your channels. So your social media links would have a different parameter, email, your ads, bing, bang, boom. And when you do that, you can see how each different channel works, whatever segment you really want. You can even be ad specific, how they convert better, if they're staying on the page just long. All the data is broken down. So I love it. They're called UTM parameters. They stand for Urchin Tracking Method. Now you may think that's a weird name for Google to come up with, but Google Analytics used to be called Urchin. They bought it, rebranded it, but they kept the UTM tracking. So anything in the URL that's after a question mark is a parameter. It's also a variable, they're the same thing. Then ampersand separate them. So you might see funky URLs with lots of ampersands and one question mark in it. And that's what it's really for, is for tracking purposes. I highly recommend doing it. It's how I slice and dice my data and make really good reporting. If you want to get into it, this is a great tool. This is how you can build these UTM tracking parameters. It's a free tool from Google. You can go here. Again, you're going to get the slides, so don't worry about writing down this entire link. You'll get the slides and you can click on it. The next section I want to talk about is the behavior. So here you'll see your site flow, page data, speed, site search, events, and experiments. Site flow. This is a very interesting graph. It's in here twice for some reason. I don't know why. But I just don't get it. I don't like this. I used to put it in all my reports, and every time I did, my bosses would be like, what's this mean? What's this mean? I would spend 15 minutes on this picture and people wouldn't get it. And even in the interface here, it's kind of difficult. You got to grab it and slide it to the right. It's so darn confusing. I don't get what they made this for. I don't ever use it. I found one good instance of this. We were working on Goodwill of Central Arizona, and I saw a loop. I saw people going to the homepage, and then they went to the search page and back, and there's like 7-8 interactions, just bam, 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 just in this loop. And I had no idea why. It was very confusing. I figured out that on a mobile devices, the search wouldn't work. You type in a search, it'd go to a blank page. They would come back, bam, 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 there's your loop, right? So we fixed that problem. This is the only time I've ever found this sort of thing useful. I recommend using this navigation summary. It's right below the behavior flow. You'll see it here. Site content, all pages. And then you got to click this tab. I'm pointing to it. I got a big arrow. I'm using my mouse. It's really hard to find this tab. I don't know why. It's great. Navigation summary. This shows you the page before and the page after people went to on the page you're currently on. It does the exact same thing. I think it's much easier to understand because that chart just confuses people. It's the exact opposite of the map chart. It just stalls meetings. It doesn't help at all. All right. I'm off my soapbox about that chart. All right. The next section, the site content. So this is all pages. This is all of the pages on your website broken down one by one. And I'm going to show you a little bit later why you want to add filters to your data, because sometimes you might have like an about us page and then somebody wrote about us with a capital A and you'll see it's 2 lines and it drives me crazy. If you're seeing that, I'm showing you how to fix it in a little bit. But here, hopefully I can answer your question, Nathan, about bounce rate. So this shows you the data for each page, right? So page views are how many times a page has been seen, right? It could be 1 second, it could be 10 minutes. It's just been viewed that many times. Unique page views are how many people have seen that page. So I have seen the page once, but I had 10 page views on it. I kept going back every day or something. Like, yeah, my horoscope or something on there. I just kept checking it out. All right, the average time on page is how long I've stayed on that particular page, not on the website as a whole. Entrances, I love this statistic for SEO because entrances, in my opinion, show how healthy your website is. If you're just getting entrances on your homepage and maybe one page, it's not that healthy of a organic site, right? It's not ranking very well. if you're getting entrances on a ton of pages, you know, your site's ranking well, it's probably very sound technically. And that's what you want to see. All of your pages opening doors to traffic, and entrances shows you that. Now the bounce rate and exit here, a lot of people don't know what the difference is. A lot of people don't know which one matters. So all bounces are exits, but not all exits are bounces. All right. A bounce is I could go to a page, be there for 1 second or 30 minutes and leave. And it's a bounce. Now people may think that's bad, but what if somebody had a very specific question? This happens on my website all the time. Like, what kind of scorpions are in Arizona? They come to my facts page, they see the types of scorpions and they leave. That's a happy user. That's somebody who's satisfied with their visit. I don't think it's bad. I answered their question. Sure, could I earn their business? Maybe they're just doing a book report, you know, and I can't get their business. You know, it's not a bad bounce. I answered their question, all right? An exit, somebody could have gone to the homepage, clicked on the About Me page, gone to that facts page, and then left. And the facts page would be an exit, all right? Both instances, they're leaving from the same page. They're both exits, but one's a bounce and one is an exit. That's the difference. I care about exits. If exits are really high on a page, you don't think they would be. Like, thank you pages, contact us pages have high exit rates. That's normal. But like, if you have a page that's mid-funnel with a high exit rate, you better go investigate and figure out what's going on and why people are leaving that page so quickly. All right. Next question, site search. So this is different than what from Google, okay? So I showed you before in the acquisition section, you can tie into Google Search Console and see what people are searching for in Google to find your website. It's unbelievable data. So this is different. If you have like a little magnifying glass on your website or people can search your website for things, that's what this is for. This is different, but this is just as good. It's gold too. It's gold, Jerry, it's gold. So if I have content marketing that I need to do, this is the very first place I look. Like if somebody's asking my website a question that I'm not answering in the search, like I better go write that article, right? They're telling me what they want to know on my website. It's a no-brainer. This is where I go for content. I'm going to go through a little use case of this because I found it very beneficial for a role I had. I used to work at Odyssey Aquarium. You guys, I'm sure you're familiar. It's a very nice place up in Scottsdale. We had a big problem when the Odyssey Aquarium launched. We had a problem with PETA. Dolphinaris, I think it's shut down now, but Dolphinaris is right next to the aquarium. There's like a 30-foot space in between, and people didn't know they were different, right? So right when we launched in September, people were really confused. They wanted to see the dolphins. People were complaining about the dolphins, leaving bad reviews. We didn't get to see the dolphins, but it's a completely different entity, right? We didn't do a good job describing that at the aquarium. And also PETA was kind of up in our hair because they didn't like the dolphins, you know, because you could swim with the dolphins. If you don't know what Dolphinaris is, you can swim with dolphins, watch the dolphins perform. It's like a dolphin thing. It's cool. It was cool while it lasted. But PETA wasn't a big fan of it. And you can see why. They were blaming the aquarium a lot. So we're getting a lot of crossfire, you know, friendly fire from this sort of thing. So I went into site search and Google Analytics. And I noticed our top six searches were for dolphin or some sort of a dolphin. So people were searching for dolphins on our website. And this is another problem. If people are looking for it on our website, 36% of our searches, over a third of them, were about dolphins, these freaking dolphins, which we don't even have. So we changed the code up on the website. So when you hit the magnifying glass and search anything with DOL, we had this pop up. We do not have any dolphins. You might be thinking of Dolphinaris, which is a separate entity. We're not the dolphin people. These people are. If you want to go there, feel free to click this link. And then we track that with UTM parameters. So when they went to that website, we could see if it converted. And it actually went so well that we put a booth up in the aquarium to sell tickets to Dolphinaris up by, I think, Otter, where the otters are, is where that was, by the kids section. And they started selling those Dolphinaris tickets. And it all spurred from us just seeing a lot of searches for dolphins and end up monetizing it using UTM parameters and Google Analytics to see that it was an opportunity and then making money off of it. So there's a lot of business decisions you can make with something just like searches on your website. So the next thing I want to talk about in behavior are the top events. These are events that you code onto your website. They're a little bit abstract. I'm not going to dive into them in this conversation here, but I'll give you a link a little bit later so you can learn all about events. What I like to put events on. So events basically allow you to track clicks on your website. I like to put events on all like submit buttons, any button on a form, I put an event on. Click to call buttons. If you have an email, you know, click to email button. I like to put an event on there too. Anything somebody's going to interact with and leave your site, I like to put an event on because then I can track when and where people are leaving, which is important to me. It might not be important to you. So events are optional. You gotta fill it out. I will say in Google Analytics 4, the new kid on block that you guys probably do not have, they do events really, really well. A lot better than this version. That's the one kudos I'll give to that platform. All right, conversions. All right, this is where the money is. It's goals, funnels, product sales, and attribution. So goals, You have to set up your goals. You can do it a few different ways. I'll show you how to do that in a few minutes in the back end. This is where the data is for the goals. It's how many have been completed, what the conversion rate is. If you have a funnel set up, the abandonment rate, and you can see where they're converting, what pages they're on, and all that jazz. It's really, really great data if you have it set up properly. So this, I think, is the biggest hidden gem in Google Analytics. So if you're, I don't know what you guys might be doing. Maybe you're shooting an email or eating a salad or something. Take a minute, look at the screen. I'm going to take a drink while you guys flip back over here. Really, the only slide I care about you guys seeing in this whole presentation is this one. All right, so this is the multi-channel funnels conversion. It's the top conversion paths. All right, so a big problem us marketers have, especially digital marketers, is getting the return on investment for like an advertising campaign, like display advertising or anything out there abstractly on the internet that isn't a direct click, you know, to a conversion. Like you could just see it, like a billboard, but on the web. Because you spend a lot of money on display advertising to be up on the displays channels, retargeting, and you're all over the place, and you can get a really low conversion rate on those because people just see them and they don't click them, right? Or they'll click them and you won't get the attribution because most sites, most companies are first click or last click attribution. So what this means, I'll go in example one here, first click attribution, organic search would get all the credit. Be like, oh, I got this conversion because of organic search. Last click attribution would be direct, right? And imagine we had 10 advertising interactions in the middle. They're blue, so it'd be blue little arrows. And you had 10 of them in there, but it wasn't first or last, so it's like it doesn't matter. It wouldn't show up in most of your reporting. Nobody would know that somebody clicked on your ad, got your website 10 times before they actually converted. But this chart does. This helps save your skin. If you're trying to figure out why an aspect of your marketing isn't working or where in the conversion path things are falling off, this is where you should go. And if you're fighting for more budget for channels you know are working in your gut, but you can't prove with the data, check out this screen. All right, I'm off my soapbox. You guys can get back to what you're doing, but that's really important. Hopefully it'll save your skin and get you some more budget in the future. Next thing I want to talk about is e-commerce. It's really easy to turn on. You click a button. If you want to enhance e-commerce, you might need a developer to help you set that up. It can get a little bit difficult, but I recommend it. You have Shopify, Magento. They do a really good job out of the box making this happen. Here's a great article about enhanced e-commerce. If you want to learn more, I highly recommend it if you do have, if you're selling products on your website. All right, settings. This is what most of you are probably here for. The settings, the admin, the backend, the scary part of Google Analytics, where we have user management, filters, goals, alerts, the tracking code, which you might need to put on your website, right? And then all the other settings. And boy, are there a lot of settings. The most important thing about optimizing your account is you have everything in order and in place. And you'll notice there's three different sections in Google Analytics. There are the account level, property level, and the view level. And then there's like all these buttons, like they can't put more buttons anywhere else, right? It's like you're in an elevator. And then you see the same button, user management's in here three times. Like why? I just want to close my screen and leave. All right, so the first thing you need to know, it is cascading, which means anything you do to the account level happens to the property level. Anything you do to the property level happens to the view level. Anything you do to views just stays in the views. It doesn't go up. Long story short, you fire somebody, remove them from the account level. Okay. So this is how it breaks down. Think of your account level as your business. Now your business may have multiple websites, which are properties, and your websites may have multiple segments, which are views. I'm gonna take a drink because this is the lengthy part here. Prepare yourself. All right, views. I love views. It's how you break up your data. I like to set up multiple views. All right, I set up one account, usually, you know, property for each website, and then I set up a bunch of views. I set up a main view. The main view has all of my filtering. It has all my goals. It has everything. Like I've pimped that out all the way. It's the best view you could have. It's where I make all of my decisions. It's where the data is. It's how my reporting's pulled. It's the thing I'm in all day, every day. And then I make another view that's unfiltered where it doesn't have any of that. It's just the raw data. So if something breaks in my main view, I know I have the raw data there. I also like to make a test view, like I talked about earlier, when combining it with the real-time section of the front end, where it's just my IP address. I filter out every IP address but my own, so I know I'm the only one they're tracking on the website and I can test things. Now, another thing you could do with views is, let's say you have a really good problem, you get sampling in your data set. Let's say you have more than 250,000 sessions in a time frame. You're going to get sampling, right? And if you want to prevent that sampling, you might be able to segment it by a state, by a channel or something, so you don't get the sampling. But that's a really good problem to have. And if you are getting that, you might think about the enterprise solution, which is very expensive. All right, so more about the settings, the account settings. My pro tip here, check it all. Just check it all. That's what I do. The benchmarking thing is cool. It gives you a screen in the acquisition section, I believe, of analytics that compares you to other businesses. of your size and your location and your industry, and shows you how you perform against them. That's a really cool screen. All right, the property settings here. I see this all the time. This default URL, they'll have like www in there, but you're not a www site, or you'll have HTTPS when you're not HTTP, or you'll have the HTTP. It's just messed up. Just double check this and make sure it's all right. And the next thing, industry category, that ties into the benchmarking a little bit. So it'll auto-populate that for you. So I always select that. This advanced setting, it says a lot of words, a lot of stuff you might not know, like UTMs, Gclit. It's super confusing. Long story short, all right, you check this box if you want to use UTM parameters to track your ads. Remember how I did that campaign example and I gave you that tool to build the URLs? If you want that to work for your Google ads, this is very specific to Google ads, you check the box. So I recommend checking the box. I like UTM parameters. Google ads will do it themselves with Gclit. They're both great. It's not really a big deal if you do it either way. But if you want to do it the UTM way, you got to check the box. All right, enhanced link attribution. So you check that. Start in-page analytics. So this kind of gives you a poor man heat mapping I never use. Search console, this is how you add Google Search Console in, which is how you get that query support. So remember how we talked about, hey, this is how you see what people search for in Google for you. This is what people are searching for in Google. This is what your keywords rank for in Google. This is how you turn it on. Enable user metrics. So if you want that gender and age data, you need to check this box and need to do one more thing to make you do two things. You check that box. And then you go down here, they hide this. It's in properties. Tracking info, data collection, all right? And you have to hit on here, and then you have to hit save. I can't tell you how many times I forget to hit save in here because you don't have to hit save in most places, but sometimes you do. You turn those two things on, and you get your age and gender. So checking this box here, just so you know, is saying you updated your privacy policy, saying you're tracking people. You know, it's important for that stuff, so you got to do it. All products here. This is how you add anything. If you're like, I've got AdSense, or I've got this random product I think I might be able to tie into analytics, check it out. They might be able to right here. All right, the view settings. All right, so view settings, exclude query parameters. This is a really cool tool. It's super confusing. So query parameters, remember I told you about tracking URLs with the ampersand UTM underscore, let's say medium equals, you know, social, you know, and you just keep going, bam, bam, bam. Anything after the question mark, right? Those are all parameters. So some websites use parameters for filtering. So let's say I'm Nike.com. Now, I don't know if they actually do this. I'm using it as an example. So Nike.com, and they have their big shopping cart, right? And I want some Air Force One shoes, all right? So I'm going to go to the Air Force One's page. And I check men's, blue, size 10, you know, and then up in the URL, they change. It's like size equals 10. And then the ampersand color equals blue, right? And you're seeing it's adding all of these data points into the URL. Well, in analytics, it just makes it all messy. That page, now every single time you put a tracking, a different way to filter it, it adds a URL, it adds a URL, it adds a URL. So you have all of these onesies and twosies in your Google Analytics for the same product page. It's all the one page, but because people are filtering it, you get like 100 different data points for it. This is how you prevent that. You can exclude all of those things. You stick it in here. This happens a lot with session IDs. If you have a website where people log in, they'll get a session ID or a user ID. So you'll see lots of people in the logged in section of your website, and you'll get like a ton of data points. Like every time somebody goes to a page is a different data point. They have different session IDs. It's crazy. You'll have thousands of data points for the exact same page. This is how you keep that from happening. All right, bot filtering. Check it. I don't know why it's not checked already. It doesn't stop all bots. Bots pop up. They're like weeds, but it gets most of them. Site search. So remember the dolphin example? This is how you turn that on. And then if you have a WordPress site, this is your pro tip. You put in S equals, and then you check this box. So the box basically says, anytime somebody searches, you won't get a single line of data for every single search, right? It'll all just be, here's the search page, one place. That's what I like. It won't be every search, will be its own. And then you can use the site search tracking to see what they're actually looking for, right? And it's better. All right, goals. There are four types of goals. There are pages or screens per session. There are duration, so that's how long you've been on the website. There's destination, a specific page that you go to, and then there's an event-based goal. I only use event-based goals unless I need a funnel, and then I would use a destination-based goal. So let me walk you through an example. I don't even use the other two. If you want to use them, you can. I don't know why you would, but maybe you want some goals like people seeing 10 pages on your website or something. That could be a goal. So we have a form. Let's say we have a form on our contact us page, and that's our main conversion point, okay? You have your form, you have your submit button. All right, so for an event-based goal, you would create an event. When they click the submit button, fires the event. The goal sees that it's a goal. Goal fired. Bam. I'm on the page. You get that little Ajax message. Thank you for filling out my form. All right, destination. All right, you click that button. You go to a new page, like a thank you page. Thank you for filling out our form. All right, it's a different page. It's the destination they reach. They reach the destination, bam, goal gets fired. Goal goes off either way. The only reason why you'd want them to go to a different page for a destination-based goal is so you can get the funnel. With destination-based goals, you can set the pages before that page that users must or may go into before they convert. And then if they fall off in a certain spot, you can use that as an advertising in Google Ads. You can create an advertising audience to it. And you can fire off retargeting ads based on where they fall off in your funnel. Didn't quite fill out your cart, check it out. Oh, so close. We just need your credit card information. You know, you can really get specific using that destination-based goal. It's really handy. I think destination-based goals are less accurate because a bot could go to your thank you page and fire off a goal, where something clicking the event, the button isn't as likely. But either way, two ways to skin a cat, does it the same way. And those are the main two goals I would use in analytics. You only get 20 goals, so use them sparingly. You don't want to set up goals for every event. And then if you have to replace a goal, I like to put an annotation. I'll talk about it a little later, saying, hey, this goal got changed. All right, filters. My whole goal for filters is just getting uniform data. So I lowercase everything, because if something comes in with like capital N in Nike and a lowercase N in Nike, it's two data points. Drives me nuts. So I just make everything lowercase. I like to add the domain because, you know, usually you're just like slash about us. But what if you wanted ama.org/about us, right? So that's how you do that sort of stuff. You can do a lot of cool stuff with filters. Check out that article I wrote for Zion and Zion. It'll tell you how to set all of those up. I like custom alerts for traffic drops. The main reason these are beneficial is I forgot to put the tracking code on the website, or I updated the site and I forgot to put it on there, or I didn't publish tag name. I don't know. Sometimes you forget to put the tracking code on the website. So this will email you when the traffic drops like 95%, 100% day over day. And you're like, oh crap, something's wrong. Let me fix this before my boss figures it out. All right. This is the article I just teased. Take a screenshot of it. It walks you through all of the admin stuff I just talked about very briefly. It tells you how to do it step by step with screenshots. It's amazing. I think this is still the highest ranking page on their website. All right, events with Tag Manager. I love Google Tag Manager. I love events. This is how you set it up. All right, so go to this article if you want to learn more about events. And don't be scared about Tag Manager. It's really easy. It's a drag and drop interface. It's come a really long way, and it is not hard to set up events. You used to have to go into the code and add attributes to tags, and it was difficult. You need to know HTML now, and I can drag and drop and set up 10 events in a minute. It's fantastic. It's great. It's very easy to get great data on your website with these tools, so check it out. Solving a spike. All right, my favorite kind of spike is a Gronk spike. It looks good in Tampa Bay, too. All right, so this is a spike. I came in one day to AMA Phoenix. I noticed, wow, there's a huge spike, much higher than most of our traffic. I wonder what happened. Did something awesome happen? I always think it's a bot when I see a spike, from a cynical nature. So I always try to disprove it being a bot and see why this happened if it isn't a bot. So the first thing I do is look in the annotations. So annotations are basically notes. Anytime you do anything to analytics, you add a page to your website, you do a new social campaign, you're doing ads, you did a press release, anything that could impact traffic to your website, add an annotation. It's going to save a lot of time. If I click this and saw, hey, we did a press release, problem solved, 5 seconds in, I know why we have a spike. We didn't do it. It was my job at the time. Uh-oh. All right. So next thing I do is check the location of the traffic. So this is for the AMA Phoenix. You guys are very familiar with the organization. And we're getting a ton of traffic from Canada. Weird. All right. That's odd. I don't expect to see a lot of traffic from Canada. So that's my red flag. I'm going to zone in on that traffic because it looks irregular. So I'm going to create a segment of just that traffic. All those Canadians were from Ontario, beautiful place. So I set up a condition using the segments. And I see a lot of this stuff up here. It's like demographic, technology, behavior. And then they have the advanced sections. Like, don't be scared by the advanced section. I think this is easier to use than the other stuff. I just do conditions. It's wicked easy. So I always go here. This is the only segmentation I use, is this advanced conditions, because you can do everything here and it's super easy. So I made the region, which is city also. Contains Ontario. So these are only people from Ontario. I've also changed the date range to November 20th, because that's when the traffic spike occurred. I'm going to check the time. So we have all these Canadians from Ontario coming to our website all on the same day. And look at what time they did it. It was like 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the morning. So 340 Ontarians came to the AMA Phoenix. I don't know if my presentation was coming up, if they were really interested, but that just seems pretty odd, right? I actually set up this bot and sent the traffic to make it look good. All right, so next, I'm kidding. next, I look at where the traffic came from, right? Where is it from? Is it from referrals? Did I get a link somewhere? Is it from social? Did something go social, go viral? But it's from direct traffic, which means somebody typed in amaphoenix.org 340 times in a 5-hour span in the middle of the night from Ontario. They didn't go to any pages. They just went to one page and bounced. And then they didn't spend any time on the site, right? This is clearly a bot. It's people out of my market at a weird time coming in direct traffic, which is odd for AMA Phoenix, right? And they're not viewing anything and they're bouncing right away. This is clearly a bot. So here's a little key, if you will. If you see a spike and based on the channel it's in, this is probably what it is. So if it's direct traffic, it's probably a bot, or you did like a commercial or something and people can remember your brand. Like if it's Nike.com, it's easy to type that in directly. But if it's like the Botanical Garden of Phoenix or something, that's not as likely to be direct, all right? Organic, it's probably brand awareness. Maybe you got a billboard up, you did a TV commercial. Paid, irregularly high spend, or you started a campaign, that'll cause a spike, right? But I like that. This is something to note. A lot of times people mess up when they're setting up campaigns and they mean to spend $500 throughout the whole campaign and do it a day. So this, if you see a spike like that, you should be very cautious. You didn't set it up incorrectly. Social, right? Something went viral, or this happens a lot. People will do an advertising campaign, like you're boosting a post on Facebook, and it comes in as regular organic social, but it really should be paid social. It's usually just improper tagging while you get spikes in social. Email, you know, popular email, and then referral links on another website or press release is usually why you see a spike in referral traffic. All right, reporting with Data Studio is the next thing we're talking about. It's a lot of data. It's hard to understand. Data Studio makes it easy. I'm not going to dive into it. I don't have time to do that. But this is a free report. Go to this really, really long URL when you get the slides. Check it out. Play around. Break it. Add your instance. And it's a good place to learn. Just use it as your sandbox. Play around in here. And I think you'll catch on pretty quickly. All right. Lightning round. This is where I talk about a lot of things and say hi to John Coe. Been a while. And Karen, good to see you. Anybody else?
It works, does it?
Old friends I haven't seen in a while.
I guess it does. Okay.
Yeah. All right.
You might lightning round.
All right, lightning round. Google My Business. If you have a business, set up Google My Business. It gives you local links.
I don't know how we get to that conclusion.
All right, 5 local SEO tips. Have your address and contact information on every page. I usually put it in the footer. Have a single page for every location. I see a lot of pizza places for some reason with locations placed with the S. Like they got one page and it's like all their locations. Like you see all the boroughs in one page. Borrows doesn't do it because I optimize their website, but you want to have a single page where every location has their own page, right? That way you can optimize specifically for that. Oh, the first person to check that. Wow, I've done this 30 times, Nathan. Nobody's caught that. Thank you. Use schema micro data to optimize your website, right? You can go into schema.org, learn all about that. Have a single page for each location. Utilize local directories like Google Maps and Yelp, and then use a syndication tool like MozLocal or Yext to get that out there on a bunch of local websites. All right, Google Search Console. If you have a website, you should have Google Search Console. It tells you everything about your website. It is fantastic. Google Tag Assistant. So if you want to know if your Google Analytics tag is on your website properly, this is an extension you add to Chrome, and it tells you if it is. It tells you what the number is. It tells you stuff about Google Tag Manager too. It's really a time saver. The mobile friendly test. I talked about the two indexes, the mobile index and the desktop index, and how you have to be mobile friendly. This is within Search Console. It tells you if your site is mobile friendly. Page speed insights. You want your site to load in 2 seconds or less. This tool tells you how to get it to load faster. Most of the time, you just have really large image files, so you might want to compress those. All right, that's also in Search Console. 6 SEO tips for a website. Have a fast website. Have a good user experience. Get that green lock in the top left corner with HTTPS, compress your images, use Tag Manager to implement your tag, and upload a sitemap to Search Console so Google knows what pages you want to have indexed. Google Ads, this is how you show up in search ads. This is how you do that, like they search for shoes, this is how you show up. Google Trends, same data as Keyword Planner you might be familiar with, but you don't have to have a credit card installed into Google Ads, and it compares different terms. So if I want to optimize for shoes or sneakers, this will tell me which one I should pick. All right, Google Voice. I use Google Voice for my business. It gives you another line to your phone. It's free. It's amazing. I love Google Voice. Google Surveys, not free. Really affordable, though. Competitive research, you know, just some research you can get out there. Not my favorite. I think the AMA has a really great research sponsor. I forget what they're called, like Western Research. So make sure to plug them at the end, Anna, but they are who you should go to instead of Google surveys for really good market research. For something affordable, this is great. And Google Drive, we all know about Google Drive, great place to keep your files. So if your hard drive crashes, you're not screwed. I love this. I got two slides left. I'm going to talk about Google Forms and Zapier because they really helped out my Scorpion Sweeper business. I used to spend 4 or 5 hours a week on my pest control business. I changed to having all my guys fill out a Google form, right, on their phone that I provided them. And that tied into Zapier, which sent invoicing reports. Everything I would need for my business was automated after using Google Forms with Zapier. And I ended up working for about 10, 40 minutes a week on my business instead of like 4 to 10 hours. It really was a time saver and allowed me to focus on other things like building the business instead of doing the business. So I highly recommend Zapier for automation. It works with a lot of tools and it's great. It's great. So I got time for a couple of questions. And just to leave this up here. If you do need any marketing help, please reach out. I see this.
So Ben.
Yeah.
Did you get to Nathan's question?
I did not. I don't think so. I'm going to do it right now. In regards to bounce rates, if the bounce rates start out reflecting data, but after a period of time, the bounce rates stop providing data, I had that come up and wanted to know how to find a solution to that. So I'm going to need a little bit of clarity with that, Nathan. If the data they're showing is 0%, that could be thinking you're not getting data, but probably what's happening is you have that tag on there twice. This happens all the time. You will have your Google Analytics tag on there twice. So imagine you're switching to using Google Tag Manager. You put it on there, but then you don't pull the old tag off the website, like in the header of the document, or you're using some sort of plugin to implement it. You have it on there twice. If it's on there twice, because it's tracking you twice, they don't think that they've done one interaction. They think they've done two interactions. So it's no longer a bounce and it's a bounce rate of 0. So if that's what's happening, I bet you have your code on there twice. If you're getting other data, like you're getting sessions and you're not getting a bounce rate, there's nothing that you could incorporate within the tracking code or anywhere in the environment that would give you just one data point and not another. It's kind of an all or nothing situation, unless it's something you turn on in the back end, which I showed you how to do almost all of those. So I don't know why that would happen unless you have two tracking codes. That's what I would say. But if you want to send me a screenshot to LinkedIn, I'll look into it a little bit longer. Any other questions?
Ben, yes, there's one that just came in from Kathy Morgan, if you can see that.
Yes, Search Console. Yeah, verifying, right? Verifying Search Console is such a pain in the butt. So Search Console, I think it is more important to your website than Google Analytics, because if you have a manual penalty, if something isn't getting indexed properly, if somebody's trying to put malware on your website, anything you need to know about your website is in Google Search Console. It's like, I just had a baby, so I just got out of a hospital, and you have all these monitors hooked up when you're giving birth. It's like the monitors to your website. It's like the EKG. It's telling the heart rate, right? Anything you need to know about your website, like how fast it is all in there. So it's great. Trouble accessing it, right? You have to verify it. So usually they default have you verify it by using your domain name provider, like GoDaddy or whatever. You can do it that way. That doesn't work very well. So I feel your pain, Kathy. What I like to do is I like to add the HTML file to the FTP. I just log into the FTP with like FileZilla. I stick the file in there and that'll verify it for me. If that's a little bit too technical for you, you can get into the head of the document and add a little tag in there. And that usually does the trick. If you don't want to get into the document either, you can sometimes verify with your Google Analytics or your Google Tag Manager instance. But when you're using the tools, you got to be the first one who sets it up, which is probably why you have the issue, because you didn't set up the website, you didn't set up the domain tracking, so it's not linked to you, so it won't verify. So I would use uploading a file or putting the code on the site.
Great, thank you. I think we'll end it there. If anyone has any further questions, I can always email Ben separately and he can answer questions after that. But otherwise, Ben, I want to thank you very much for being here with us. It was awesome. I always learned so much. And everyone, I do already have his presentation. So even before the video is done and ready, I'm just going to send it to you tonight. This way you have it. And again, if you have any questions, you can please let me know and I can always get Ben to answer these questions. But Ben, thank you very much for joining us. And I'm going to close out with, I would like to thank our sponsors, of course. Our sponsors are the ones who really help the AMA be here and present everything, present all these speakers. So I would in particular like to thank Financial Potion, which is Taylor Wellman, who was with us at the top of the hour, and Elizabeth, who is her team member. And if you have any video needs, please consider Financial Potion. And if you need Taylor's contact info, I'd be more than happy to give it to you. And then also, I would like to thank our supporters. These are the companies who employ our board members. And without them, we just wouldn't be able to get what we get done. Our board members work very hard, and we thank the employers that they give their people the freedom to work with us and put the time in. Before I even go any further, I would like to acknowledge that here at our webinar, we have four Spectrum, AMA Phoenix Spectrum winners. So Elise Meyer from Prism Global Marketing Solutions, Lisa from Shasta Pools, Brittany from Ideas Collide, and Bree from Acre Inc. PR and Marketing. We are thrilled that you are joining us. And of course, you do such great work. You were rewarded with a Spectrum Award or more than one. So congratulations, and I'm glad you were able to join us. And then last, I would like to just let you know about the next event, which is Wednesday, September 22nd. And again, it is a Zoom webinar. It's lunchtime, so 11:30 a.m. to 12:30. And we are having Shilas Gamiri speak. He is from New Wine Digital. And kind of a tag on to today's Google Analytics talk, he's going to be talking about the latest Google Core update. So adapt your SEO strategy to master Google's latest Core update. I had a conversation with Shilas, and what's happening is a lot of companies are finding that their website traffic has changed, and it's all due to some changes in Google and the algorithm. So please join us. In fact, leave this webinar, and I sent an email out yesterday, and there's a link to Eventbrite, and sign up for the webinar. We will be sending out another email tomorrow, which is Friday. I'm all screwed up what day it is today. And there'll be a link in there as well. So we hope to see you on September 22nd. Otherwise, everyone, thank you for joining us. We really appreciate you taking the time with us. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. I don't know about everyone else, but Google Analytics, it is something that I absolutely need to, I need to know and understand better, and coming to events like this really helps me. I will tonight send out the presentation slides. Once the video is done, we will give you that as well. And for some of you who have not filled out our survey, I'm going to be sending you a link to our survey. So we would appreciate if you would fill that out and help us with some information we're looking for. But thank you, everybody, and have a great remainder of your Thursday afternoon.